Welcome to the Nightly Rant with your hosts,
Mike
and Torya.
This is the show where we examine society from a sarcastic point of view.
If you like insane conversations, this is definitely the show for you.
Let's get into today's topic. YPN people, I don't know about you, but I love helping out a friend. That's why I want to shout out my friend Brian Little and his podcast, Your Favorite Blockhead. This is the only show that manages to weave together peanuts and MMA into one heck of an amazing podcast. You can find Your Favorite Blockhead wherever your favorite podcasts reside and at yourfavoriteblockhead.com. Do me a huge favor and listen to Brian's show. You'll be entertained and you'll help out a friend. Now, as I said, let's get into today's topic. So today I wanted to ask a question, okay? And you can give as many answers to the question as you want. They can be different answers, obviously.
Can they be snarky?
It can be snarky. They can be whatever you want.
All right,
but
down.
I want to know what the year 2020 taught you.
People are dumber than even I thought they were before that.
People are dumber than even you thought before that. Explain. What do you mean by that?
Well, it's not even that people just did some kind of dumb things. It's the way everybody acted in the face of a shitty year and a shitty situation.
Oh, you mean all of the expert virologists that were born of the internet?
Right. Yeah. Everybody was suddenly an expert in everything virus. Everyone was suddenly an expert in everything medical. Everyone suddenly knew everything to know about everything. And if you didn't agree with their Wikipedia level knowledge, you were an asshole and you were an anti-vaxxer and a pandemic denier and a moron and a Republican and
and a Trumplican and yet et cetera.
Trumpansee.
Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, I hear you. And I'm with you on that one. I'm with you.
And on the other side, the people who also were Wikipedia level experts in all things science that disagreed that the pandemic existed, if you disagreed with them, then you were a Biden ass licker and you were I don't remember all the things.
But see, the thing you're finding out is people who are really hardcore into politics are generally not honest people.
No, I don't think that you can shine the shoes of either major political party in this country and be an honest person.
No, because the one side makes it all about the other. Did you hear today that Kamala Harris tried to blame the border situation on the Trump administration? You know, the Trump administration who said, sorry, you're not coming in. You have to file for asylum the legal way. We're not letting you in. And if you come in, we're going to kick you right out. And that's how it's going to be. Or the Joe Biden people, oh, come on down. We believe you should be allowed to come in our country and work and do whatever you want to do.
You know, when I was in Canada and I voted in political elections, I always voted for one specific candidate, one specific party at the federal level, because I really liked their leader. And I really thought there should be a woman as one of the major leaders to counteract all of the men. Because we think
Fair
a different
enough.
Way.
Yes, we do.
Okay. I always thought that. And I always voted that direction. And when she got elected, I was really proud of her. And she always spoke
is
up
this,
for what
this
she believed
Rachel
in.
Rachel something, another lady?
This is federally.
Oh, okay.
This is Elizabeth May.
Okay.
And while I may not agree with her all the time, she always speaks up for what she believes.
Okay.
And I think that's rad. Then Rachel Notley got elected as the premier of Alberta, and I was very proud of her. I have never seen a politician take their laundry list of campaign promises and just check them off one by one. I have never seen it before. She did exactly what she said she
was
going to
do. You know why? Because that's what she intended to do all along, was
exactly.
do what she said she was going to do.
And I'm not trying to say at all Canadian politicians are better. I'm specifically talking about these two women. And I was so proud of them for exercising their good female voice and being a good representation for the gender. But Kamala Harris, she is a disgusting representation of what it is to be a woman in politics. I think that she's just the worst. I think that she got where she's at for all of the wrong reasons. I think she did really, really disgraceful things to get where she is. And I think she treats the position as though she was owed it because she has a vagina.
Well,
and that's disgusting.
And also, to go beyond that, there's the whole, you know, oh, well, it's always been the plan for me to go to the border. But it only took her 93 days to get there. You know, if it was always the plan, why did it take 93 days? I'll tell you why it took 93 days. It would have taken longer, but Trump said he was going to go there with Governor Abbott.
Right.
So they decided, oh, no way. We're not letting him steal the thunder. And they went there. Let's be real. It was more to circumvent Trump than to actually do anything. And then where she went wasn't even a border facility. That's the best part.
All right.
But so that's what you those are two things you've learned. Something that I learned, we sort of touched on with something you learned,
okay.
Is the sudden influx of experts on issues, you know? And typically they don't respond in a normal discussion type manner when asked a question. They just post a link. Here's another.
Yeah.
Which doesn't really mean that they know shit, you know? It just means they've read some articles and they think that the articles say what they want. Whereas I always try when I have an opinion on something to present my opinion on my own.
Well, you know, that's another reason why I think people are overall stupid, because they just put like 100% of their trust in these articles without doing any kind of verification on who wrote them or what their credentials are.
Right.
I feel like I could go and write an article and I could make up a fake name that sounded kind of real and sciencey, and put a doctor in front of it and start a website and start publishing all these articles that are just bullshit.
Yeah.
I've always been creative at writing.
And then you've established your own authority.
Yeah.
And
because I put doctor in front of my name.
You get to say something that changes the course of the world if you want.
I could go to Shutterstock and I could use Rosa Cruz's daughter as my pictures because there were some doctory ones of her.
Yeah. Daughter.
That's an inside joke for all of your friends.
If you've been around, you know. If you don't know, you haven't been around.
Go back and listen to our first 100 episodes if you want to know
back into that first 100. The classics. I mean, we're creeping up on 400.
We passed 400.
We've passed 400.
Yeah.
Wow. Like, that's just... That's just insane to me.
404 or something.
Yeah, that's insane to me. Yeah, it is about 404, I think. That's insane to me that we've had that many episodes. And you know what? I'm going to be honest.
People
some of our episodes are terrible, and some of our episodes are mediocre, and a lot of our episodes are really good. And then there's a few, like maybe 50.
Trash that bag
are
basketball.
Just the best crap ever. A lot of times it happened to involve a friend of the show was on the show. A lot of times it wasn't. The trash bag basketball episode is like the classic episode.
I can top Patrick
from Newport Beach.
I can top him now, by the way.
Patrick from Newport Beach was a hilarious episode. And this is where the roots of this show came from, and it's where this show needs to go back to.
Because we have no idea what those episode numbers are. If you search the Nightly Rant and the names we've just given you, trash bag basketball.
Yeah, you'll find
Patrick
it.
From Newport 100%. Beach. You'll find them. 100%. Sometimes I find
and you can just go yogispodcastnetwork.com and then go in the search box and, you know, put that.
That too.
You'll find it.
Google, YPA, whatever.
But it's rad. Anyway, what I was going to say is that I don't believe in just blindly listening to things. And I believe in, like, giving our opinion. And I think sometimes for some of our episodes, we've kind of towed the mark because we didn't really want to stir up any controversy. And while I'm not going to purposely ever stir up controversy, I think I'm going to more or less talk about my opinion from now on, what it is. And I'll make it very clear that it's my opinion and not fact.
Uh-huh.
But I feel like that needs to be done. I mean,
I feel like
I'm not going to be, you know, quiet anymore about it.
I feel like people who've listened from the beginning, one, know that we interrupt each other 100 times a day, and two, know what our opinions on all of the major issues are, because I feel like our regular people are smart enough to pull them out.
Well, but like this episode right now, the one we're in right now, why are we talking about what did we learn from 2020? Because 2020 was a effed up year.
2020 gives me a headache.
And
I would prefer to just delete
it.
It
showed us so much about society and people as a whole. It just did. And so you learn things. So, you know, that's the one thing that I learned.
Question. before you continue.
Go for it.
If I can cancel a musician or a YouTuber or whatever because they were trash and did trashy things, why can't I cancel the year 2020 for being trash and doing trashy things?
Yeah.
This is a new movement I'd like to start. The two things we're going to do are cancel the year 2020 and bring back the word rad.
Rad would be rad. I would like to hear people saying rad.
Move on.
But yeah, the point being here that nobody's expecting like to control the outcome. You just have to be honest about your opinion on something. And if you're honest and I'm honest, we wind up over here somewhere.
Yeah.
And that's where we belong then, right? Because we're a couple and that's where we belong. Your opinion, my opinion, and merge together, you go there.
So you were going to tell us the second thing you learned from the year 2020.
Yes, that people, they don't want to listen to what anyone says. They just want to insist that their understanding of what you said is actually what you said.
Okay.
So if I said the sky is blue because Brie painted it blue, and you came back and said, no, the sky is blue, that's all, you leave it at that, that's not what I said. But you're going to argue. But you're going to argue that that's what I said.
We only 50% agree. The sky is blue, but Brie didn't paint it that way. And I'm okay with that because I'm an adult.
Well, okay. That's kind of where I was going. Like, there's no need to like insist your opinion is the right one for either side. And those of you who say, well, why would you defend your opinion then if you didn't think it was right? Duh. Yeah. You wouldn't even express your opinion. If you said something and I 100% agreed with you, the only way I'm going to let people like openly know right away that I agree with you is if the direction we go as a group hinges on whether or not you survive this confrontation.
Do you know what people can do in the second half of 2021 to be happier people?
Let's hear it. Because that's from the learnings of 2020, and we barely scratched the surface of 2020.
This is the learnings of even before 2020. This is the learnings from the 2016 election cycle.
Yes, to now.
If everyone would open their fucking ears, clean out the wax, pull out the cobwebs, clean out those ear canals, and listen to what the other person is saying, and pick out the parts they agree with, and be like, oh, X, Y, and Z, I 100% agree with you on those. But A, B, and C, I disagree. I actually think D, E, and F. Then they could start from a place of, oh, you don't think I'm a complete idiot. You only think I'm a half an idiot. And everybody would be happier and be able to have conversations. And if you people can pull it off, gold star.
And it's not that hard, actually, to do that. You know what's funny? You know what makes me laugh, though? I love that you brought that up because there are times, and it's, you always give in, always, because you know it's the right path to take. But you sometimes, when I'll do what you suggested just now to you, you'll go, I'm not cooperating. I know what I'm supposed to do, but I'm not going to do that. Nope, not doing it.
It's because I'm
And then you'll eventually realize that, well, the path with the least friction is probably the easier and better path.
Once in a while.
Let's go that way. And you'll go, all right, fine. And you'll kind of go into it. It just makes me chuckle because you just proved that you 100% know and agree that that's the way to handle that situation. But when it's handled that way towards you, you're just like, no, I don't want, you're not going to tell me what to do. I know what it's about because I'm the same way.
When we're having a discussion about something, you know, the topics you can't discuss over polite dinner.
Yeah.
Politics, religion, and sports.
Uh-huh.
When we're having a discussion about those things, you and I always practice that. We point out the part we agree on and then say, I disagree with this other part because
of this. And it's way less energy to do so.
It's a polite way
It's way less energy to do that. We don't need to litigate every point.
Exactly.
You only litigate the points that you don't agree on.
Correct.
And even then, you might not litigate them at all. You might be like, well, you say this and I say this. Look, we're never going to agree on that. Let's just agree to disagree. But at least you approached the issue.
Say you said the sky is blue and it has 17 clouds in it right now. And I said the sky is cyan and it has 18 clouds.
Yeah, we didn't agree.
Parts we agree on is that there's at least 17 clouds.
And that there are clouds in the first place.
And that the color of the sky is in the family of blue.
Yes.
So the parts we can disagree on are the exact shade of blue and the existence of the second cloud. But why do we even need to talk about the parts we agree on? They're irrelevant at this point. We agree on them.
Exactly. There's no point in debating those things.
It makes the conversation take half as much time and be half as feeling hurting.
Well, and honestly, if you think about it, the person thinking that there's 18 clouds versus the person who's thinking there's 17 clouds, if they want to just be peaceful and just get by, they could just be like, all right, fine, there's 17 clouds.
Maybe I'll see something you don't see.
I will believe there's 17 clouds.
That's why I used that example.
Well, but it's, yeah, because it's the angle you look at things from, 100%.
Maybe you're looking at it from where you're sitting and I'm looking at it from where I'm sitting and there happens to be a telephone pole in the way and you can't see cloud number 18.
Right.
Or maybe because of the telephone pole, I think cloud 17 is actually two clouds.
But the point would be, how I put it this way, you don't have to agree. You don't have to like say, all right, fine, I appease you. You're the right one or you're the wrong one or whatever. You don't have to agree. What you do have to agree on is the difference important enough to discuss? Because in my opinion, 17 clouds versus 18 clouds, that's not important enough to discuss. I'm going to say we agree. Like that's close enough that we agree.
Right.
You know, if you said 17 clouds and I said 117 clouds, all right, now
we need to discuss. But in the year 2020, the number of pleats in the cotton mask that some dumbass so diligently sewed in their house to protect their face from things one iota of the size of the holes in their mask, the number of pleats in that mask was something everybody had to argue online about. People who agreed masks should be worn were arguing about the number of pleats you could have in the cloth mask.
I missed this fun. Yeah, I'm glad I missed this fun. This does not sound like fun. This sounds like not very fun.
A very nice lady was making cloth masks for people for free and posting it in our community group.
It is very
nice. And some dumb fuckwad attacked her and was like, you're making them wrong because it has four pleats instead of three. It's not going to protect people from the coronavirus. And I was like, all righty then. She like lost her shit.
But the people who didn't believe in the masks, for instance, we were the cultists.
Yes, we were.
We're the cultists. They're over there agreeing that the mask should be worn, but now how many pleats should it have? Yeah, they're the cultists for sure. Like that's just weird.
Also, I get a gold star for mocking that person in our group without stuttering, speaking that fast.
yeah. But these are the kind of things that you see when you go through a crisis like that, is you see the shittiest people, you see the best people. And the good part is there's enough of the good people to give you hope that things are going to be okay.
Yeah.
You know? And that's, for me, what's really important, because, you know, I have, you know, I've got Mitchell and Alyssa that are still super young, and I want them to experience like a good life, not, you know, some suppressed, you got to stay at home, where are your papers? You know, I don't want to see that.
Through this pandemic, we chatted with a number of our friends about various pandemic things. And one friend completely 100% disagreed with us, but was respectful like always. Another friend completely agreed with us. So that's cool. There's obviously no reason for concern there. And we had a couple of friends who were like half and half. But we were lucky enough not to have any friends who were just like, you don't want to wear a mask? Fuck you, I'm out.
Well, but that's because in turn, don't let the listeners mistake, in turn, we showed them respect when we were in their presence to do what they wanted and felt comfortable with. Because here's the thing. If we know the mask doesn't stop it, then it doesn't really matter whether we wear the mask or don't wear the mask. So if the other guy is going to be willing to have fellowship with you and talk and laugh, as long as you wear a mask, well, it's worth it for an hour or two of fun. It is. It's worth it. I mean, and if it's just a placebo effect, like I feel it is, then it's a placebo effect. Who cares? You got to spend that quality time with somebody that was missing. I mean, that's what people were killing themselves, man. And that's the biggest learning I've had.
All right.
Mental health problems are extremely prevalent.
Do you know the media in America seem to finally fucking figure that out too?
Way, way, way more prevalent than anyone ever thought.
This country notoriously shits on people with mental health issues. just poops all over them. It is not okay to talk about that kind of thing in America.
You're right.
But all of a sudden, in the last like 4 months, the media realized that teenagers were offing themselves because they just couldn't handle this crap. And all of a sudden, the media wants it to be okay to talk about mental health.
Yeah,
MTV is the only media option that gets any props because they've talked about it all along.
Yes.
Everybody else can suck it. At least they're talking about it now, but the worst.
MTV's a little too woke for my liking, but...
Well, I just meant they talked about mental health.
As far as their approach overall, I applaud them for their approach.
If it was a Teen Mom episode that talked about Caitlin's struggles with depression or
something else,
there would always be a mental health disclaimer at the end.
Resources.
Or the ones that talked about whatever her name is.
Gets really big props for it?
You're the worst.
Sorry. I'll tell you after.
Or the episodes with that blonde girl and her boyfriend who was a drug addict. They would always have addiction resources at the end. Now I'm done. Now you can talk.
Dr. Drew, he gets mad props. He's been saying on Loveline for like 20 years, mental health resources.
Yeah.
20 years! He's been preaching it, man. Preaching it. That's a good thing. You know, Dr. Drew, stand-up dude right there. Dr. Drew.
I don't understand people, though. People. Anybody who says a mental health illness isn't a real illness because they can't see it. Well, sir, you have heart disease and I can't see that.
Yeah.
I also can't see your diabetes or your obvious stick-induced constipation.
High blood pressure. You don't see it.
I see none of those things. So why is a chemical imbalance in your brain any different?
Well, exactly. It isn't. And people are afraid to talk about it. But... that's the thing. It's way more prevalent than people think. That's why so many people were committing suicide once life got disrupted. That is why it's not guns that are the cause of mass shootings. It's mentally ill people were the cause of mass shootings.
Well, and we've discussed this before, that extremist religion is a form of mental illness.
Yeah, well, it has to be because it puts you into a state of delusion, if you ask me.
If you're hearing a voice that's telling you to blow yourself and 400,000 other people up with a bomb strapped to your chest, you have a mental illness.
Yeah, there's something wrong with you. I mean, there just is. But I don't know. I think that's my like biggest overall learning from 2020 was that mental illness is way more prevalent than we ever thought, and we need to start doing something about it. And it's why I've been kind of attentive to the mental state of my children, etc., you know, because if you detect any kind of change, you got to probe and find out what's going on.
Yep.
And that's my biggest learning right there. So, that's all I got for you.
Well, if that's it, then.
Curveball. Strike!
If that's all you got, man, then good night, everyone.
Still a bye-bye, Bree!
Thank you for listening to The Nightly Rant.
If you enjoyed the show, please give us a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts or Google Play.
If you didn't enjoy the show, please just ignore that previous request for a rating.
This has been a Yogi's Podcast Network production.